This is a Media Lab podcast. Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. You know, today we get to delve into the song Please Hello. This is the song, of course, that introduces us into Act 2 of Pacific Overtures. And I'm super excited for the guest that we have here today, Donatella Galella. She is an associate professor at the University of California, Riverside. And because of another guest on this show, I became familiar with an article that she wrote, or maybe an essay that she wrote, called Feeling Yellow, Responding to Contemporary Yellow Face in Musical Performance. That is going to be in the show notes to this episode, so I definitely recommend going and reading the entire thing, because I think it's a really well thought out view how we really engage with theater, musicals, in our contemporary age, and grappling with the representation that Asians have had in Broadway history. Now, before we get into that conversation, just a couple of things. First and foremost, a couple of weeks ago, when I was talking with Matt Koplik about Welcome to Kanagawa, we, or at least I, was a little bit curious about what the glue referred to in those lyrics, about why you would be using it in a sexual context. Well, I did get an email from Rob, which was just entitled Glue Sex, which is now my favorite email I have ever received in my entire life. Anyways, he writes and says, I think glue refers to lubricant or lotion. Lotion play in Japanese is known as gluekake, although he writes in parentheses, I am not speaking from personal experience. No shame if you even were, Rob. No shame. So perhaps that is what they are referencing. I would not put it past Sondheim to have known that and kind of use that within the lyrics itself. So who knows? But that is probably what they're referring to. And then secondly, very quickly, I am putting out the call, please email puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. If you know of any other productions of Pacific Overtures that I should listen to, I'm going to be recording the episode on all the different recordings that there are. So, of course, we know the original Broadway cast, the revival here that we're talking about, and I also know about the London version that I will be discussing in that episode. But if you know of any other available or that I can fairly easily get access to, please email those to me so that I can take a look at them. Oh, and there's also two instances of racist language inside this song, like calling an entire group of people by a certain word. I will not be saying those lyrics. I will just be letting the music speak for itself in those sections. But without further ado, let's get into the episode. Donatella Galella, thank you so much for joining me here today.
Thank you for having me.
I think this is going to be really fun to jump into Act 2 of Pacific Overtures here together. One thing that I've appreciated about you specifically, you know, I read the article that you wrote called Feeling Yellow. One of the things I loved is like at the very, very end of it, the exact quote, and I'm losing a lot of context here, I realize, but you write, I enjoy being an anti-racist feminist killjoy. I guess in what context in just musical theater in general, what do you mean by that in the broader musical theater context?
Yeah, so as a scholar and teacher, one of the most satisfying aspects is when you're educating people about the systemic problems of an artwork that you can take a lot of pleasure in, but often they reify these structures of power, these systemic inequalities. And when you point them out to people, they often respond very poorly to you pointing that out, and they blame you for the problem, mm-hmm. when actually the problem is in the cultural production and in our society that facilitated that, that made it possible. And actually that some of our enjoyment is because we are embedded in those inequalities, and many of us have privileges that benefit from those systemic inequalities. So I feel often very bad having to see racist representation, for example. And then I feel a little bit better if I can make someone else feel badly because now they are aware of it and they can't be unaware of it anymore.
Yeah, I think that that is something that even myself have been really educating myself, yes, but like really deeply internalizing over the last couple of years specifically. You know, as a big film fan, in as well as a musical theater fan, you know, you go back and watch things that were produced in like the 60s and 70s, like, whoa, why is it I've never noticed this before? I was so steeped in like it being made kind of for me that it's like, of course, this is distancing to other people. Like, but for some reason, it's just been I've been blind to it this entire time or unaware of it this entire time. So I think that it's good to continue to have those conversations instead of just you know, walking into something like it's of course, it's great because we produced it for the last 40 years. So, of course, it has to be still good. As someone who enjoys musical theater, like Stephen Sondheim himself, like how do you view him in just like the pantheon of musical theater?
I mean, I agree that he's a genius, particularly with his lyrical dexterity. And a lot of his musicals are among my favorites, like Company, for example. And yeah. I, like you, as we've discussed before, I've become more and more fond of Pacific Overtures the more that I've seen other productions of it and appreciated, in particular, the opportunities for Asian American actors and to some extent some of the representation within the show. So I am a huge admirer of him. I've seen many of his works, sought him out in speaking. I'm currently in a Sondheim study group with some others who are based in the Cambridge, Boston area. We spoke with John Weidman yesterday as a guest.
But
I also, as I too have become more aware of racial politics, I've also noticed that in his work that most of the time he focuses on well-off white people who are mostly straight, cis.
Yes.
And sometimes when you look at his comments on other shows, you realize that he has a very normative white approach that he actively upholds. Famously, there was his letter about Porgy and Bess, where he didn't like attempts to try to revise and maybe make the show a little more sensitive about Black representation. He has defended the yellowface casting in Miss Saigon. He gets prickly when you criticize some perhaps anti-Latinx aspects of West Side Story. And so that troubles me, but that tracks when you look at his work.
Yeah, and again, this is something that I have to contend with here too, having a podcast that's like specifically devoted to him, is that time over time, it's like, yeah, like the vast, vast majority of his shows are like well-off white people dealing with problems. Now, yes, I think that there is the songs that he has written, I think, can transcend cultures and time and stuff like that, but we still have to be upfront by that too. I can still appreciate the work, but be like, this is a little bit weird, I guess. Maybe that's the wrong word. But, you know, you have to contend with that criticism as well. That being said, like, this is kind of the outlier in most of his work. And it's fascinating, like, as you point out, like, yes, he's absolutely said, like, I don't think that it absolutely has to be, like, a Latinx person who is portraying people in West Side Story. And yet in this show, he has kind of come out and said, it really does need to be Asians on stage doing Pacific Overtures or it doesn't work. There was this London opera version, I think around 2004 or something like that. There was all white people that were doing Pacific Overtures. And he went to see it and said that. It's like, this show does not work when it is all white people trying to put it on. Can you recall the first time you were introduced to Stephen Sondheim?
It was in high school when my then partner introduced me to Sondheim shows because his parents were Broadway actors. Mm. And so I remember just listening to a lot of cast albums, Sweeney Todd, Into the Woods, Assassins, A Little Night Music, which I loved at the time, Company, having seen the Broadway revival with Raul Esparza, with whom I'm obsessed.
Yeah.
I saw also the Roundabout revival of Pacific Overtures. And so I just actively sought out his works. You know, I remember when I first got to college and seeing that the library had the documentary about the cast recording for Company, and I just rewatched Co-op the other day.
Which is great.
So that was a really formative period in high school. And I grew up in New York City. I'm from there. I started seeing Broadway shows for my 10th birthday. So this had been...
What was it that you saw on your 10th birthday?
It was the revival of The King and I, which is fascinating now that I study Asian American representation and yellowface. And at the time, I remember I was upset because I considered it an old people's show, and I had wanted to get TKTS tickets to Smokey Joe's Cafe, which I realize now is also an old people's show. But at the time, I had grown up listening to these kind of oldie songs. And so I was disappointed that we couldn't see that, but we saw The King and I was just blown away by the theatricality of it. I was scared by the drums, apparently, but it's just such an interesting show that was the first one for me.
When was the first introduction to Pacific Overtures?
I think that was when I saw the Roundabout revival starring B.D. Wong, and I remember being excited to see him. I had seen him in You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown on Broadway, which is actually the first time I saw an Asian American play a typically white role. And I was a little confused, but excited by that as a child. I remember being kind of bored by it. I was probably 17, but also, you know, it's such an overwhelming story. And then I really came, I think, to have a lot more fondness for the show when I saw the production at Classic Stage Company stripped down by John Doyle and seeing this amazing cast, you know, Anne Harada, Tom Sesma, Austin Koo, George Takei. And I just really loved it. It felt like they were taking more control of the narrative, and it was just so focused on the story here.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I'm excited then to jump into this song, Please Hello. But before we do, though, just to do some more like a table setting here, one of the other quotes I pulled out of your article was this section where you write, if I were to be included and feel like white musical theater goers, my inclusion and feeling would not abolish systemic racism. For Asian Americans to gain entrance to the theater, the price is keeping quiet about charges of white supremacy and playing the grin and bear it model minority. And when you take a look at this, like in 1976, when this debuts, at the same time, the revivals of O Calcutta, Porgy and Bess, and The King and I are also playing on Broadway. So this coming in that type of environment seems like extra bananas to me. It would be unlike anything I think people were thinking about. And you can read about some of those responses at the time where people are like, I don't understand this. Like, what's going on? It seems to their words like foreign to me. So do you have any, I don't know, thoughts or opinions about that, about like how this is vastly different?
Yeah, I think it was hugely innovative first to try to recruit an almost all Asian American cast. There's some sense that maybe a couple of people were not, but trying to pass as Asian American.
There's at least one, and now I'm forgetting their name, but actually outright lied and said he was Asian when he was not.
But that was huge, particularly because there was an earlier production of It's a Bird, It's a Plane, It's Superman, which in which Halperin's directed and did cast white people to play the Flying Lings. So I thought it was like first very important that he would seek out people and give these opportunities to Asian American performers. And then the fact that they're trying to write it from a Japanese perspective and using real kabuki elements, as well as other Japanese theatrical conventions like Bunraku with the puppets, for example. I thought that was really innovative for the time, as opposed to people like Rogers, who was very proud of himself for never having researched Thai music when composing The King and I. And so there was some sort of attempt at actually understanding this other culture and positioning it from a Japanese perspective. They're the ones telling the story here. At the same time, you know, there are aspects of the show that do repeat Orientalist tropes at the same time, and Yellow Peril, especially at the end with the song Next. but it's such a disorienting show, I think, if you're presuming a white American audience who might not be familiar with Japanese history, who might feel uncomfortable seeing these critiques of American colonial violence trying to so-called open up Japan for trade and seeing themselves not centered in the story. And then they might not be familiar with these conventions of Japanese theater.
That's a fun thing for me, too, is just like the form that this takes. I didn't go to university for a theater degree. I eventually got an English degree, but I took a bunch of theater courses. And so we did a huge section of that on traditional Japanese theater. So I'm familiar with, a little bit with No. And so I can see those forms that they're playing around with and like using to comment on and that sort of thing. I continue to come back to the fact like, boy, like in 1976, this must have seemed so bizarre to come into and be like, oh, this is not what I thought. I thought I was going to come and see, you know, the King and I in it. This is not the King and I in any shape or form. Talking about history here, though, how much do you know about Japanese history?
Only a little bit, because I myself, as a professor, now teach global theater history. And so I teach about Japanese kabuki no bunraku and takarazuka, which is this form from the early 1900s of an all-women's musical theater review inspired in part by shows in France and Broadway musical theater. And so, for instance, a few years ago, they came to the U.S. for the first time and they performed their all-women's production of Chicago at Lincoln Center. So,
that's interesting.
Yeah, and actually I use specific overtures when teaching about Japanese theater and teaching about Japanese history to I play the clip of Please Hello to ask them about like, what is the historical moment happening here and how is that history being told?
And it should be just mentioned here too, like this is using like actual history within this song, although very, very compressed. This is not really happening all at the same time, but over many, many, many years. Essentially, what is going on in this song is that Lord Abe is being, you know, visited by five different nations' representatives as they kind of keep opening up their world. So sorry for breaking into the conversation here, but there are some people and organizations that I need to thank. First and foremost, if you'd like to help support the show for absolutely free, you can give a rating and review on whatever app you listen to podcasts in. It's really greatly appreciated. And if you'd like to help monetarily, which will only help to grow and make this show better, you can do so over at our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. By the way, huge thank you to Edward for becoming a new patron here this week. I also need to give a huge thank you to the God That's Good tier from Patreon, the triumphant quartet of Jack, Todd, Carrie, and Witty. Of course, Putting Together is also a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. The Alberta Podcast Network promotes and supports Alberta-made podcasts and connects their audiences with Alberta-based businesses and organizations. This episode of Putting It Together is brought to you by Alberta Association of Optometrists, proudly celebrating a century of caring for Albertans. You know what happens? Parents can easily miss their child's eye problems. Issues can occur in only one eye, making them difficult to notice. The earlier an eye health or vision problem is identified, the more likely it can be corrected. The ICI Learn program provides an eye exam and free glasses if needed for kindergarten-aged children. 25% of kids begin first grade with an undiagnosed eye problem. To book your child's eye exam, please visit optometrists.ab.ca. The Alberta Association of Optometrists represents almost 800 doctors of optometry in over 80 communities across the province. Members are highly trained, regulated health professionals who provide primary eye health and vision care to Albertans. Learn more at optometrists.ab.ca. This episode is also brought to you by the Shift podcast by Alberta Innovates. Shift showcases the work being done in the province's innovation ecosystem, everything from health to clean energy. Join hosts Katie Dean and John Hagen as they interview the researchers, entrepreneurs, and businesses that are shifting our perspectives about innovation in the province. One of the more recent episodes is entitled Creativity, Research, and Being an Entrepreneur, where they talk with Jenna Rieger from True Angle Medical Technologies. They delve into her journey from researcher to entrepreneur and the help that she and her partners received as they grew. You can find Shift Podcast by Alberta Innovates on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you listen to podcasts. And you can also find it at shift.albertainnovates.ca. That's shift.albertainnovates.ca. So it starts off by the American Admiral coming on and singing, "Please hello America back, Commodore Perry sent hello. Also comes memorial plaque, President Fillmore wish bestow. Emperor read our letter if no, Commodore Perry very sad. Emperor like our letter if so, Commodore Perry very merry. President Fillmore still more glad. Last time we visit too short, this time we visit for slow. Last time we come with warships, now with more ships, say hello. This time request use of port, port for commercial intention. Harbor with ample dimension.
Please hello America back, Commodore Perry send hello. Also comes memorial plaque, President Fillmore wish bestow. Emperor read our letter if no, Commodore Perry very sad. Emperor like our letter if so, Commodore Perry very merry. President Fillmore still more glad. Last time we visit too short, this time we visit for slow. Last time we come with warships, now with more ships, say hello. This time request use of port, port for commercial intention. Harbor with ample dimension. But you can't only
one. I love that the American Admiral is portrayed in this way, in which he's not singing in a standard elevated English. It's like it's a messy translation where he's trying to speak in Japanese and therefore doesn't have the precise wording for it, but he's still conveying his meaning. And he's still very highly confident and competent. He's still having rhymes in his songs. And we already see at the start here how Sondheim is trying to write lyrics where it's like, you know, if you do this, then here are the consequences. If you do that, here are the consequences. And a lot of the song operates in this kind of binary, but it's a false binary. There isn't really a choice for Abe because there's the looming threat of the battleships here. I also love that the song is called Please Hello and it starts that way. It's like, those are some of the first words you learn in another language, right? And so I like that. In some sense, it's keeping the Japanese centering and perspective by making it so that the Japanese people speak technically, formally, perfectly, while the American Admiral doesn't. So it seems to have this power imbalance. And yet at the same time, like in actuality, it is the American who has more power here.
Yeah, and I think if you, I've watched the recorded production of the 1976 version that's on YouTube, and you can even just see that, like, just the way that they portray the American Admiral, just like chest out first and like just like marching. This is a pastiche of a Sousa march too. Like he's using this very intentionally, but it's just like, yes, that is very American. It's like I own this, I know everything, and I'm going to tell you what's going on here, sort of thing. I love what you just said here, though. I guess I had never put that together about how the fact that please and hello are usually two of the first things as you try and learn in a different language, because you can get very, very far just by having those two words. He continues on here. So now Abe and the American Admiral kind of go back and forth, but Abe says, but you can't. And then the response is only one little port for a freighter, but you can't just for fun, be a sport, maybe later. But we bring many recent invention, kerosene and cement and a grain elevator, a machine you can rent called a train, maybe later. Also cannon to shoot big loud salute like so, and then there's a huge explosion. Say hello.
But you can't.
Only one little port for a freighter. But you can't.
Just for fun, be a sport.
Maybe later.
But we bring many recent invention, kerosene and cement and a grain elevator, a machine you can rent called a train,
maybe later.
Also cannon to shoot big loud salute like so.
When that explosion happens, the American Admiral, I think, is trying to show, like, how great is this? But it feels like a very, like, dire, like, warning, like, hey, by the way, we have this that we can use at any time.
Yeah, it seems like it's a demonstration, but it's also a threat. And you're saying in the staging, you can see again the uneven status levels of the actors, how they're behaving. And most of the time, Abe has to sign like on the floor on someone's back. But even in the lyrics, you see that Abe is not the one who gets to be clever and have more space and to be able to rhyme. He is saying but you can't repeatedly, and then the maybe later. And so that's showing he's starting to relent because he doesn't have much of a choice, and then is starting to actually rhyme and coincide with the Admiral's lyrics.
I think that, like you said, visually you can see he's usually either on his knees or like structurally he is made to be shorter than what the American is. My love of rhymes is like is on display here because I just like how this huge list of stuff like kerosene, cement, grain, elevator, but then that rhymes with train, and later then rhymes with elevator too. So he's actually doing these like little interesting double rhymes. And I say this repeatedly all the time on this podcast, but I love it when Sondheim is able to rhyme things when it doesn't even seem like he's rhyming things. Like this does just feel like he's listing stuff off. But then when you read it out, it's like, oh no, this rhymes with that, that rhymes with this. And he's doing all these internal things here too. As far as I know, I did look this up here. Abe was a real person, or at least is an amalgamation of like a real role that was there at the time. But I don't think any of these other like the five representatives are just like made up for this show. Like there definitely probably was representatives that came to Japan, but they're not meant to be any like specific person here at all.
Yeah, that's a good point that again reminds me about how there is this kind of critique of Orientalism, which tends to generalize all Asian people as the same. And so there's a reversal here where we have a specificity to Abe as the first counselor to the Shogun, but then we have all of the Americans, all the British people, all the Dutch sort of stereotyped into this one person who doesn't even get to have a name.
Right. So we continue on here. Abe singing. No, sorry. This is not him. This is the American Admiral saying, "Treating meet approval, if no, Commodore Perry very fierce. Disregard confusion below. President Fillmore now named Pierce." And this is Abe signing the treaty, of course, here now on the floor. "Good. At last agreement is made. Letter will let us come again. First result of mutual trade. Commodore getting letter letting. Counselor getting fancy pen. Goodbye." And then Abe says goodbye. And there's like goodbye, goodbye, please, goodbye, hello, goodbye, hello, please, goodbye.
"Treaty meet approval if no. Commodore Perry very fierce. Disregard confusion below. President Fillmore now named Pierce. Good, at last agreement is made. Letter will let us come again. First result of mutual trade. Commodore getting letter letting. Counselor getting fancy pen. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Please, goodbye.
Hello.
Goodbye.
Hello, please.
Goodbye.
Please.
Yeah, for me, this is another example of the kind of opposites going on in the song, the hellos and the goodbyes, the appearance of diplomacy, but you're also threatening to shoot these people, the kind of politeness that's here, but the looming threat. And so there's a lot of this kind of like doubling happening here.
The big standout here for me is Commodore getting a letter letting, Counselor getting fancy pen. Just, yeah, using those kind of, again, internal rhymes here really, really, really nicely. And then the fact that they only get a little fancy pen in return for, like, signing away their rights.
Right, and then later in Bowler Hat, you see that one of the changes is the writing instrument that he's using.
Yes. Then the British Admiral comes in. So, yes, this is a pastiche of Gilbert and Sullivan. And if you have the book Finishing the Hat, you will know, or if you've listened to interviews with Stephen Sondheim, Sondheim hates Gilbert and Sullivan, like outright hates them. Whether you do or not is beside the point, but this is a pastiche of them that he's doing. And so the British Admiral says, "Please, hello, I come with letters from Her Majesty Victoria, who, learning how you're trading now, saying hallelujah, gloria, and sent me to convey to you her positive euphoria, as well as little gifts from Britain's various emporia." And then the reciter repeats and says, "The man has come with letters from Her Majesty Victoria, as well as little gifts from Britain's various emporia." And then Abe asks tea, and the British Admiral says, "For drink." And then I see, thank you.
"Please. Hello, I come with letters from Her Majesty Victoria, who, learning how you're trading now, saying hallelujah, gloria, and sent me to convey to you her positive euphoria, as well as little gifts from Britain's various emporia.
The man has come with letters from Her Majesty Victoria, as well as little gifts from Britain's various Emporia.
Tea for drink. I see. I thank you.
I think.
One thing that I noticed, and I know that it's written in the same meter and everything like that, but you can actually sing this song exactly to the same tune as a modern major general completely. Mm-hmm. So try it out at home, everyone. But you can actually sing that to the exact tune.
I am the very model of a modern major general. I've information, vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England and Dakota fights historical from Marathon to Waterloo in order categorical. I am very well acquainted too with matters mathematical. I understand equations both the simple and quadratical. About Bonomial theorem, I am teeming with...
Here and then in the next part, I'm really interested in why the reciter is copying the things that the British ambassador says. And to me, it's that, again, he's the narrator. He's a kind of chorus as well. But for me, it also foreshadows that he is going to reveal himself to be the Meiji emperor, who ultimately is going to support assimilation to Western standards. And so I wonder if that's suggesting that that's why he is so willing to mimic the lyrics here. In addition to, of course, it being a Gilbert Sullivan pastiche, so you need to have a chorus who just repeats what has just been said by a protagonist. Yeah. But I wonder if that's part of the dramaturgy, too.
I think it is. And like, this is also the thing that Sondheim has issues about. Like, he writes about the fact that he just gets really bored because of that repetition that happens a lot of time in Gilbert and Sullivan scores. He also just doesn't find them all that funny, too. But in this one, it's like, if you actually watch that 1976 video version, what I find very interesting about it, as at least the audience that's in attendance, doesn't seem like super responsive to what's going on for most of the show. And this is like, you actually finally hear like laughs and stuff happening in the audience. But I think it's because like, oh, like I know Gilbert and Sullivan. So like I'm tuned to laugh because they write funny things. And so this obviously is a funny thing too. So it's that weird psychosomatic thing that's happening to probably the predominantly white audience that's in attendance to watch the show.
Reference humor. I understand this. This pleases me.
And so the British Admiral continues on and says, I think her letters do contain a few proposals to your emperor, which if of course he won't endorse, will put her in a temper, or more happily, should he agree, will serve to keep her placid, or at least till I am followed by a permanent ambassador. And then the reciter repeats, a treaty port and from the court, a permanent ambassador, a treaty port from the court, a permanent ambassador, a treaty port from the court, a permanent ambassador, and more.
Her letters do contain a few proposals to your emperor, which if of course he won't endorse, will put her in a temper, or more happily, should he agree, will serve to keep her placid, or at least till I am followed by a permanent ambassador.
A treaty port and from the court a permanent ambassador. A treaty port and from the court a permanent ambassador. A treaty port and from the court a permanent ambassador and more.
It's fun that he rhymes temper or with emperor, though. Just to finish this off here, just because it's a lot of the same stuff here. The admiral continues on saying, Her Majesty considers the arrangements to be tentative until we ship a proper diplomatic representative. We don't foresee that you will be at least a bit argumentative, so please ignore the man of war we brought as a preventative. And then the reciter repeats that. Yes, please ignore the man of war that's anchored rather near to shore. It's nothing but a metaphor that acts as a preventative. And then the British admiral says, All clear, just so, sign here.
Her Majesty considers the arrangements to be tentative until we ship a proper diplomatic representative. We don't foresee that you will be the least bit argumentative, so please ignore the man of war we brought as a preventative.
Yes, please ignore the man of war that's anchored rather near the shore. It's nothing but a metaphor that acts as a preventative.
All clear. Just sail. Sign here. Hello.
Yeah, for me, this is just about how threatening and hyper-competent the British are here as an empire. And what's interesting is that the American did not speak perfectly, but the British admiral does. So there's actually inconsistency in the approach here, or it could be commentary on maybe the British are better at being colonizers, which they were at this point. Historically, the U.S. doesn't really become this colonizing empire until the Spanish-American War in the late 1800s. And, you know, I'm really struck by the internal rhymes that start happening in these stanzas, like, until we ship a proper diplomatic representative, we don't foresee that you will be the least bit argumentative. So please ignore the man of war we brought as a preventative, and how the reciter, like, runs away with this rhyme and keeps adding and adding and adding. to it. And so there's a way that you could read this as, again, about the expansion and the influence of this colonizer. And we'll also start seeing here references to different commodities. So there is the reference to the, you know, the stuff from the Emporia, the tea, which is from British colonies and which Japan already has, actually. And then that's going to be foreshadowed with what happens with the Dutch lyrics.
And I think that's the thing that knowing a little bit about history helps you enjoy this even a little bit more. Sondheim writes in Finishing the Hat how proud he is that this is, quote unquote, like historically accurate as far as like what they were trying to trade, what they were going after, the deals that they were made, and even how the other nations responded to the fact that Japan decided to start dealing with other nations besides them. You find out very quickly that America is, they like to be the only one that's trading with people. They don't like it when they have to share trade. To that point, the American admiral comes back and says, "Hello, hello, objection, resent, President Pierce say moments pause, British get ambassador sent, President Pierce gets extra clause." And then this is when the Dutch admiral enters in and says, "Wait, please, hello, don't forget the Dutch, like to keep in touch, thank you very much. Tell them to go, button up the lips, hold everything, we're going to bring chocolate. Wouldn't you like to, want at least a beautiful little piece of chocolate? Listen, that's not to mention wonderful, pay attention, windmills and tulips, and wouldn't you like a wooden shoe? There, can you read? Good, we will need two ports, one of them not too rocky. How about Nagasaki? Two ports, one of them for you, for Coco. How do you call it? Yokohama? Ya, Nagasaki, ya, sign here."
Hello, hello, objection, resent. President Pierce, say moments, pause. British get ambassador send. President Pierce, get extra clause.
Great! Please, hello, don't forget the Dutch. Like to keep in touch. Thank you very much. Tell them to go, button up their lips. What do little nips, what with battleship? Hold everything, we gonna bring chocolate. Wouldn't you like to lease a beautiful little piece of chocolate? Listen, that's not to mention wonderful, pay attention, windmills and tulips. Wouldn't you like a wooden shoe? There, can you read? Good, we will need two ports. One of them not too rocky, how about Nagasaki? Two ports. One of them for the Coco, what do you call it? Yokohama? Yeah! Nagasaki? Yeah! Side here!
Yeah, so this is interesting to me because of the Dutch person emphasizing the chocolate, which again is from the Dutch colonies. And so again, these aren't just like innocent products that they have in their own country, but because of the expansion of their own power around the world. And so it might seem like, oh, this is innocent trading in which we mutually benefit, but because of the precedent, which they are already directly alluding to, you know that it's not going to be an equal exchange necessarily. I also think the Dutch character is the most farcical of all the admirals here.
Oh, yeah. He is made to be look the most buffoonish out of all of them, which is interesting. I don't know why it's the Dutch necessarily. I guess just because people like to make fun of Dutch people. I don't know. I grew up in the 90s, so I still remember like Austin Powers making fun of like Dutch people, even then.
There are only two things I can't stand in this world. People who are intolerant of other people's cultures and the Dutch.
I feel like maybe they are the easiest target here in that perhaps from an American perspective, there's more charge to mocking any of the other four.
One of the big things, of course, here too, what they're talking about is they're talking about tulips, which was like a huge like economic driver. If you don't know about the history of like tulips and tulip flowers and how that really was the economy of, I was going to say Dutchland. That's not the name of
the Netherlands.
The Netherlands. Oh my gosh. Was the economy of the Netherlands. They're definitely bringing in like what was actually happening at the time. I also like because he actually has a tulip that he brings out and gives to Lord Abe usually in this section here too. Which, by the way, they also mention the city Nagasaki in this one, which I know a lot of people will know from like World War II and the atomic bombs. But in history, even though Japan was closed off at this time, they actually were allowing Dutch ships to be in Nagasaki at this time, even then, to do some trading. They just couldn't come onto the mainland. So once again, this is all wrapped up into the actual history of what's going on. The American Admiral comes back and says, wait, please, objection again. Dutch getting too many seaports. President now wants 3 ports. And then the British general is overlapping with this, saying, Great Britain wishes her position clear and indisputable. We're not amused at being used and therefore stand immutable. Our foxy chaps indomitably inscrutable. And then the Russian admiral breaks in here and says, please, hello, wait, please. The Dutch admiral responds, wait, please, hello. Comes the monkey wrench. Smell that awful stench. Probably the French. This is all overlapping, as they say. The American is to also insist giving free ports. British is saying, reviewing it from where we sit, the facts are irrefutable. And then the Russian breaks in again and says, please, hello. Dutch admiral says, Och nein, of course, my mistake, the czar. Smell the caviar, leave the door ajar. Americans are saying, also want annual reports. The British admiral, and thus in short, a single port is patently unsuitable. Where finally the Russian gets broken in here and actually can say something. And he says, please, hello, is bringing Tsar's request, braving snow with letter to protest. Since we know you trading with the West, you might at least, don't touch the coat, start looking east or closer west. Well, farther north. Are we the 4th? I feel depressed. Don't touch the coat. Coming next is extraterritorially. Noting text say extraterritorially. You perplexed by extraterritoriality. Just noting clause, don't touch the coat. Which say your laws do not apply, don't touch the coat when we drop by, not getting shot, no matter what, a minor scrape, a major rape, and we escape, don't touch the cape, that's what is extraterritoriality.
Wait, please, objection.
Great Britain wishes her position cleared and indisputable.
Dutch getting too many.
We're not amused at being used and therefore standing mutable.
President now wants to.
And though you chance a foxy chance of damn me,
wait, please, hello, comes the monkey wrench. Smell that awful stench, probably the French.
Also insist give
reviewing it for where we sit, the facts are indisputable.
Nine, of course, my mistake, the czar. Smell the caviar, leave the door ajar.
Also on annual.
And thus assure the Singapore is patently unsuitable.
Hello. He's bringing Tsar's request, braving snow with letter to protest. Since we know you're trading with the West, you might at least, don't touch the coat, start looking east or closer west. Well, farther north, are we the 4th? I feel depressed. Don't touch the coat. Coming next is extraterritoriality. Noting text, say extraterritoriality. Are you perplexed by extraterritoriality? Just noting clause, don't touch the coat. Which say your laws do not apply. Don't touch the coat when we drop by, not getting shot, no matter what. A minor scrape, a major ape, and we escape. Don't touch the cape, that's what is extraterritoriality.
So that's a lot. A lot of that is sung over top of one another. Mm-hmm. And this is where I get into is like, there is no way anybody would really know what any of these people have said, besides the Russian admiral there at the end, unless you are reading out the lyrics or have gone and seen the show multiple times.
Yeah, adding to what you're saying, I think that there's a chaos here that's supposed to be mirroring what's happening historically with these different nations kind of battling each other for trade dominance in Japan. And so that's playing out in how we can barely understand what's happening here. We talked earlier about how the British Admiral is very directly using these anti-Japanese tropes of using this slur against them and calling mm-hmm. them inscrutable, which is a really famous stereotype about how, oh, you just can never understand those sneaky Asians. And so that's just really plain, as opposed to the veneers of diplomacy that some of the other people have. But we again get back to some of the other admirals speaking in this choppy, not perfect way to show that they don't have total facility with the Japanese language. But again, they all have guns and ships with which they are threatening Japan. The joke about the coat is very funny.
Yeah.
And we also know from finishing the hat that these are, again, mirroring different cultural song styles. So the Russian is singing in a dirge-like fashion. And then this part also, when I was watching also the filmed 1976 production, I was really aware that the way all the ambassadors were entering was from the audience on this bridge.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they were on this bridge called the Hanamichi in Kabuki theater. And so to me, this suggested that they're outsiders, like intruding, but they're also coming from the perspective of a presumed white American audience going onto the stage. So again, I just thought that how Prince is staging here is doing so much kind of like metaphorically that's mapping onto the storytelling and the lyrics and music here.
Yeah, I think that even if you weren't able to verbalize that, just the staging itself does so much of the work that you can't help but think, oh yeah, they're arriving from somewhere else. They're not just there already. This is funny. I Sondheim is often criticized, and he actually criticizes himself often too, about him not being funny. I think this is one of the exceptions. I love the Russian admiral. The don't touch the coat is great, but I also love the whole lines like, you should be trading with the east, but we're actually west. Well, kind of north, I guess. So it's like, yeah, that's pretty clever as far as like geographically where Russia is situated here. This also gets really wrapped up again into like the socio-political nature of the 1850s. At the time, even like Britain had this like rule that they didn't want Russia to try and take over any more of Asia than they already had. And like they had they were trying to protect India at the same time of not letting them like expand any more of their reach. So they're at kind of in fighting mode here too. So anytime one of these new people arrive, any of these new admirals arrive, just the part like, okay, well now we want like free ports and we want an additional one here. And like none of them are happy that all these other people are arriving here. By the way, do you know, I could not find anything, and maybe I'm just not searching for the right thing. Do you know if the don't touch the coat thing is just something funny, or is that something that's a reference to something?
I don't know if it's a reference to something. Yeah. I think it's just a good joke.
I think so too. Like, I couldn't mention, like, is this like, did the Russian Tsar hate his coat being touched or something? Or is there a superstition or something around this? Anyways, I couldn't find anything. So if anyone out there knows, please let me know, because I would love to hear if that is a reference to something. I couldn't find anything specifically about that. He continues on, though, the Russian admiral, and goes, fair is fair. You wish perhaps to vote. What we care, you liking that what we wrote. Sitting there in his finest fleet afloat, observing boat. Don't touch the coat, just sign the note. And then the British admiral comes back and says, the British feel these latest dealings verge on immorality. The element of precedent imperils our neutrality. We're rather vexed you're giving extraterritoriality. We must insist you offer this to every nationality. And then we get a bunch of overlapping things. So the Dutch guy goes, we want the same what the Ruskies claim. Why you let them came, dirty, rotten shame. And the Americans are going, USA, extreme upset. President Pierce say very solid no.
Fair is a fair. You wish perhaps to vote. What we care. You liking what we wrote. Sitting there is fine as fleet afloat. Observing boat. Don't touch the goat! Just sign the note.
The British feel these latest dealings verge on immorality. The elemental precedent
in the same. But the USA is high upset. President Pierce is
please allo, please allo. Allo, allo, allo. Mwah!
The only thing I will say, like, so it's the Russian who brought up the extraterritoriality, like he used that word like 3 or 4 times. The British brings it back here, but actually rhymes it with something, which the Russian guy doesn't, which I find interesting. So he's rhyming vexed with exed, and then retoritariality goes on to the next line. Here comes my next favorite section, because I like the French guy too. Mostly I just like where the melody changes here again for the détente section. So the French admiral arrives and goes, allo, please, allo, please, allo, 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 allo. I bring word from Napoleon's III. He had heard what have occurred ere from the little bird. Undeterred, we conferred, though we felt that we'd been slurred, and the verdict was he spurred me ere to bring the word. Would you like to know the word from Napoleon's III? It's détente, oui détente, that's the only thing we want. Just détente, ou détente, no agreement could be more fair. Signing pacts, passing acts, there's no time for making warfare when you're always busy making with the mutual détente. A détente is the only thing we wish. Same as Zen, except additionals the rights to fish. We'll be paid, you'll be paid, and we'll abs a big parade if we somehow can persuade you to accept our aid. It is not to be afraid. And there's a big explosion again as we merely wish to trade.
Allo, I bring word, from Napoleon's III. He had heard what had occurred here from the little bird. Undeterred, we conferred, so we felt that we'd been slurred. And the verdict was he spurred me here to bring the word. Would you like to know the word from Napoleon's III? It's détente, oui détente, that's the only thing we want. Just détente, oh détente, no agreement could be more fair. Signing pacts, passing acts, there's no time to make the warfare when you're always busy making busy mutual détente. A détente, that's the only thing we wish. Same as them, except additional, their rights to fish. You'll be paid, and we'll have to be guided if we somehow can persuade you to accept our aid. It is not to be afraid, as we merely wish to trade.
Again, so fun with the repetition, the rhymes, the speed, the can-can here. And again, yes, the kind of falsity of the kind of like alacrity and up-tempo fun sensibility. But again, they are threatening to shoot you.
That's the thing, right? Like, that's like the not even subtext for some of this stuff is like you're going to sign this or else we know we have guns, right? I like it when you can go on runs here and you keep getting impressed by what's being rhymed. You know, you have paid, parade, persuade, afraid, trade is great. And then even earlier, we have pax, axe, warfare, fair. Anyways, there's this whole run that you can keep going on. That I almost want to like just keep going. Like, why not? Mm-hmm. Well, just add even more rhymes into this and see if there's additional stuff that you can kind of get to. Sondheim loves going into French, I find, because this is like the third time I think he's written like a fake French song. So I don't know if I know that he's a big film fan, and especially a lot of the French directors, he was big. So I don't think he actually knows any French. Or maybe like enough to like be able to rhyme different things here and there. But it's interesting. He goes back to this well quite a few times of using like someone who's basically speaking with a French accent so he can rhyme different words together.
Yeah. And I think it's funny that he even writes the accent into the lyrics, right? Like having a Z in there.
Okay. So this is like the hardest section because basically the whole rest of the song, except for like the very end, like everyone is singing over top of one another. So I'm going to try and do my best here. The French admiral is going, a détente, oui détente, that's the only thing we want. Leaves a grain, leaves a train, put champagne among your imports. Tell each man that Japan can't be bothered giving imports while he's in a tizzy, dizzy, wizzy, with a mutual détente. Abe is going, it is late and I fear, well, you'll see, there's a famine. Could you wait for a year? We'll agree to examine it, but we've had a quake and a flood and a famine. Please believe we will take it to study, examine it. And all the animals start singing together, saying, the French is saying, just détente, oh détente, no agreement could be more fair. Signing pacts, passing acts, there's no time for making warfare. Why discuss, makes a fuss, since the West belonged to us, and the East we have leased for the French administration. If you force in the Norse, then we burn the Dutch legation. The Dutch admiral is saying, wait, please hello, don't forget the Dutch. We want just as much fishing rights and such. Tell them to go, otherwise we post battleships at most. Ports along the coast, you can have the West, we will take the rest. The British is singing, one moment, please. I think that these assure us exclusivity for Western ports and other sorts of maritime activity. And if you mean to intervene as in the Dutch proclivity, we'll blow you nits to little bits with suitable festivity. The American admiral is going, wait, please, hello. West is ours. Wait, please. The East is the best coast. We'll trade you two on the West coast. The Russian is singing, please, hello. No seaports on the West. United States too near to Tsar. Is tempting fate. Is go too far. And then he kind of breaks this whole like chatter that's going on again with say, don't touch the coat. Then they all sing the same thing by going, ah, detente, that's what everybody wants. You should want a detente, make a nation like a brother. We'll be here every year to protect you from each other and to see you aren't signing foreign treaties and detentes. Please, hello, we must go, but our intercourse will grow through detente as detente brings complete cooperation. By the way, may we say we adore your little nation and with each heavy cannon wish you unending please, hello.
Champagne among your imports. Tell each man that Japan can't be bothered giving imports while she's in a tizzy, dizzy, wizzy mutual detente.
It is late and I fear, well you see, there's a famine. Could you wait for a year? We'll agree to examine it. But late, I fear, there's a drought in Paddy Farm. If you wait for a year, then no dog will get some time.
One million times I think that these are shitty and I'm fine.
We will wait, we will know West is hard. The battle sheets are cold.
We will pass.
United States has made us all and kept the
England with us.
Don't touch the coat!
Au détente, they're what everybody wants. You should want au détente, makes a nation like a brother. We'll be here every year to protect you from each other and to see you aren't signing foreign treaties and détente.
Please, hello, we must go, but our intercourse will grow through détente as détente brings complete cooperation.
By the way, let me say, we adore your little nation and with heavy cannon wish you an unending please, hello.
Like singing over top of one another and then coming together at the very end, very a Sondheim thing to do. But what do we want? What do you want to pull out of here that's being sung?
Yeah, I think I mostly want to highlight how Abe is trying to stall, but he's very ineffective at it. They're not letting him get in more than a few words. He doesn't get to have that eloquence. And so again, it's just showing how he doesn't have much of a choice here.
Yes. Yeah. Like it's, he gets that one section, like it's the most he's been able to sing this entire song. Mm-hmm. But he's trying his best, right? Like, hey, we've had a famine. There's been an earthquake. There's been all this other stuff. Like we need to slow down. It's like, ah, you're okay. And like, they can't keep going on. And again, visually what's going on here, because this is the detente song is off of that French can-cam. They're doing a kick line, mm-hmm. right? While they're singing this and kind of bringing him into the fold that way. It's interesting visually that, as much as he tries to push back, that they're like, meh, we don't need to listen. I do want to say, like, and again, I don't, unless you really, really listen, I don't think you can really tell what any of these people are really singing all at once. I love the British Admiral in this section specifically, like maritime activity, the Dutch proclivity with suitable festivity. Like they're, those are great little rhymes that are going on. And then, of course, the West is ours. Wait, please. The East is the best coast. We'll trade you two on the West Coast. So, just, I don't know. Interesting that they're playing around with, like, the sides of Japan that they want to actually be almost carving out here at the same time. And this is an entire show that is really designed or marketed as, like, this, like, intersection between East and West.
Yeah, absolutely. And showing how, actually, there's a lot of overlap going on here. And as you pointed out, historically, the Dutch, for instance, did get to trade earlier. There's this, you know, the show really portrays Japan as somehow pure and closed off forever, when actually that was only during the Tokugawa shogunate period. And they did that for a reason, because they were sick of earlier periods, like in the 1500s, of like the Portuguese missionaries coming in and bothering them. So like they've already had this kind of contact. And in the British section, again, I love the inner rhymes for Western ports and other sorts. If you mean to intervene, it's just so clever.
Yeah, I think that's the thing. And that's something that I even pointed out. I already recorded the episode for Floating in the Middle of the Sea, the very first song in the piece. And I mentioned that. It's like, it's so interesting that we open this show as like, Japan is like this idyllic a nation where nothing bad ever happens. It's like, well, I don't know if the samurai period is like all the greatest period either. But it's interesting that they do that. Although the lyrics of some of the people in that do suggest like maybe not everything's like the greatest going on here. But that's definitely what the higher ups are believing. It's like, we're this like great nation. We don't need any of this intervention. So it definitely like compresses history, kind of overlooks things, which in some cases you kind of need to do if you're, you know, adapting like this huge amount of history. But yeah, I agree. I think you have to be aware too. It's not like a true 100% historically correct document. They're playing a little bit fast and loose with some of the storylines that are going on here. So like in general, I want to start off with like the Please Hello in relation to the rest of the show of Pacific Overtures. How does it work for you?
First, because it starts Act Two, it's kind of an obverse mirror to the end of Act One with Someone in a Tree, because they're both songs about treaty negotiations, but they're done very differently. The first, Someone in a Tree, being about what are the available ways that one can access this history and this negotiation, hearing or seeing parts of it, and then looking back on this history, and it's from a Japanese perspective. And then we switch to this other, like, really, like, violent and, you know, from these European perspectives of what's going on here. But you were also making me think that the chaos at the end and how hard it is to understand the words might be putting us in Abe's position of being overwhelmed by all of this. But the sound of the song, because it's so directly drawn from, you know, there are pastiches of these other European songs, it's a huge break from everything that we heard from Act One. But then it sets up that the rest of Act Two, we're going to see more and more Western cultural influence on the characters and how that also shapes the song styles.
Yeah, like for me, it's an interesting thing to think about, because you've ended Act One with Someone in a Tree, which, I mean, even Sondheim says this, but it's like that mini Rashomon almost that you're getting in like that one song. You go for your intermission, whether that's like a smoke break or grabbing something to drink. You're coming back and it's like, whoa, like what is happening? Like this is an explosion of stuff that we haven't even seen at all in Act One. But it also does introduce you to what Act Two is trying to do. Like, okay, now we're seeing that creep of the West into Japan a little bit more. And that's kind of what Act Two is all about. It's like we were here and now we're here. And I think it's a great way to introduce us into it. And like I said, it is a nice like little fan. The audience loves this just based on the people's reaction, even to that 1976 one, just because it's like it's fun. Like there's a can-can dance. There's humor and everything that's going on. So like it works definitely in that way. More broadly, you've seen a production of Pacific Overtures. Do you feel like this is something, should is maybe a big word, but can it be revived? Or is this something that's like, you know what, it's this piece of musical theater history, it is part of the Sondheim like oeuvre, but like maybe there should be other voices that are being brought out instead of reviving this again?
I really appreciated the John Doyle revival because it felt more like I was hearing the perspectives of Japanese people and got to see these great Asian American actors who, again, there are so few roles for, and so many of the other canonical shows like The King and I and Miss Saigon are just so much worse representation-wise. But on the other hand, there are Orientalist aspects. As you were saying, the portrayal of Japan as somehow pure, unchanging, stagnant, kind of backwards, primitive, and that's just not true. But I've also thought about how the reciter, again, because he ends up being the emperor, I feel like he has a bias toward the West, actually, in the way. So it's like his view that is skewed in giving us this portrayal. But I don't know how cognizant spectators might be of such an interpretation, because we're all like embedded in Orientalist views of Japan that we might just take things at face value. And then I have a lot of difficulty with the last song next, because it's so threatening. It feels like scary portrayals of Japan, and particularly when this show is coming out of the mid-1970s and going into the 80s is when we're seeing a rise of the Japanese industry. And we have mentions of, you know, how many Toyota dealerships there are in Detroit, when Detroit is this icon of American car production. And then we have to remember in the early 80s, two white guys murdered Vincent Chin in a bar before he's going to get married because they were just laid off from auto work and they assume him to be Japanese and they just kill him. And then they get basically no justice for having done that. So there, the consequences of reproducing these images of Asian people as scary, as threatening, as foreign others has real consequences for violence and systemic discrimination when you get off stage. So, you know, there are aspects of the show I really enjoy, and historically I think it's so important. And at the same time, for me, right now I'm obsessed with a new show by David Henry Hwang and Jeanine Tesori called Soft Power, which is deliberately an inversion of The King and I. I love it so much. It's so funny. It's so critical of white supremacy and American politics. And it's critical of how musicals act as propaganda. And so it's very meta as well. Mm-hmm. And so I wish that we could provide more opportunities for this kind of new work that lets us hear different kinds of voices, tell different stories, and learn more. And for me, like, laugh more.
Yeah, I think, two things. Number one, I really hope Soft Power gets a Broadway run, because I'm pretty sure that was just a Chicago production, if I'm not mistaken.
It originated in Los Angeles at the Amundsen Theater, then it went to the San Francisco Curran, and then it went to the Public Theater in New York.
But the second thing is, like, that's the conflicting notion I have with Next as well. Like, it almost, like, how am I supposed to read that as an audience member? Is this like, yay Japan, or is this like, oh, beware Japan? Like, it almost, it's like a version of like Don't Feed the Plants from The Little Shop of Horrors. It's like, it's like, this is kind of a weird way to end the show. You've been doing all this like interesting work with like characters and big ideas, and like that's how you end. It's like, by the way, like, this is what they're doing. So yeah, I think you have to have that critical lens when you go and see some of these shows to be like, okay, like, I can enjoy aspects over here, but like, what's going on with this section over here? Well, Donatella, thank you so much for joining me here today. This has been really great. I'm going to put a link to it, but if people want to go and read your article, Feeling Yellow, I really recommend people do that, because it's really great. But if people wanted to stay in contact with you, see what you're up to, is there a way to do so online?
Yeah, so you can reach out to me through my university email address, which is galella@ucr.edu. And thank you so much, Kyle. This was a really fun, interesting conversation.
Cool. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. You can also follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. And you can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Thank you to the Alberta Podcast Network, to the Alberta Association of Optometrists, and to the Shift Podcast this week. Putting Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, we'll be talking about Bowler Hat. I mean, it's called a cutaway. As always, a big thank you to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and to Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.
We must go, but our intercourse will grow. Do they talk as they talk? Needs complete cooperation. By the way, may we say, we adore your little nation. And with heavy cannon, wish you an unending peace and love.